Okay, good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We've got no apologies this morning, and we're joined this morning by Christine Graham, MSP, and Bob Dorris, MSP. So welcome both to the meeting. So our first item of business is to consider whether to take item 5 in private. This is to consider our approach to stage 1 scrutiny of the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. Are we all agreed? Thank you. So our next item of business is consideration of the following negative instrument. That is the Dangerous Dogs Designated Types Scotland Order of 2024. And I refer members to paper 1. So I welcome to the meeting this morning Siobhan Brown, Minister for Victims and Community Safety, and Mr. Jim Wilson, Licensing Team Leader at the Criminal Justice Division of the Scottish Government. So welcome to you both. So can I invite the Minister to speak to the SSI?
Good morning, Convener, and good morning, Committee. Thank you for the opportunity to provide the Committee with information on the safeguards the Scottish Government is putting in place in relation to the XL bully dogs. The vast majority of dog owners are responsible animal lovers and know that owning a dog brings with it important responsibilities. Whilst a dog attack remains a rare occurrence, where they do occur, they can have devastating consequences. Such incidents illustrate the importance of responsible dog ownership and effective enforcement by Police Scotland and local authorities of relevant dog control laws, and we have public safety always in mind. As I made clear in my statement to Parliament last month, the decision to introduce the initial new safeguards on XL bully dogs was not one that we made lightly. We wanted to ensure that we took an evidence-based approach after engagement with relevant stakeholders, which I carried out following the UK government's announcement of their legislation. What became clear after the legislation came into force was that the UK government could not confirm that an owner of an XL bully dog who lived in England and Wales and who wasn't able to sell or rehome a dog in England could not do so in Scotland. So whilst to do so would be breaching English and Welsh law, it did create a loophole that led to some owners bringing dogs to Scotland. Therefore, we moved to take action immediately to introducing this new legislation. I am determined that we promote and support responsible ownership, animal welfare and public safety as effectively as possible. Our approach is in two parts, with the first legislation that you have before you today. And the effect of this legislation is that from the 23rd of February, being this Friday, selling, gifting and exchanging an XL bully dog will be prohibited and that loophole will be removed. Owners of XL bully dogs remain legal to own an XL bully dog, with owners having to ensure their dog is muzzled and on a lead when in a public place. Our second phase will be to make it an offence to own an XL bully dog without an exemption from the 1st of August. Further secondary legislation will shortly be laid that will provide for the detail of the system of owners applying and paying for an exemption by the 31st of July. This will allow owners to make plans and prepare for the new safeguards. We will continue to engage with a wide range of stakeholders as we prepare for the implementation of the new safeguards. A new stakeholder forum has therefore been established, which will meet regularly over the next few months. Convener, I'm happy to take any questions that the committee may have.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Minister. So we will now move to questions. And can I bring in any member who would like to ask a question? Okay, I'll bring in Fulton McGregor and then Sharon Downey.
Thank you, Convener. It's not so much a question, but more of a wee statement. I want to firstly thank the Minister for an engagement with me on this issue, and indeed those in my constituency. And I want to thank Kelsey Kiernan, her family, indeed the whole team at Bedley Gardens Dog Care in Cryston in my constituency, and including the many experts that they have on site, and those such as the Blue Cross who have provided us briefings on this, because I'll be honest with you, prior to this issue, I didn't have a great knowledge of the XL bully situation, but I feel that I do now because of the information that I've been provided by constituents and experts. And I have to say that I do think there is, and the Minister knows that I think this is very bad legislation from the UK Government. And why I say that is I know that perhaps my Tory colleagues here will say, well, it's an attempt to make society safer. But on committees and in this Parliament, I think we've always prided ourselves on listening to experts and listening to those who actually know the situation. And the experts in this field are clearly and consistently telling us that this is bad legislation. It has a high risk of not working. It's knee-jerk and it's ill thought out. And therefore, I think that the UK Government really had a duty to listen to those experts. To me, I might be wrong, I might stand corrected here, but to me, it feels that the legislation has been pulled through by UK Government ministers and officials and not experts. Now, all that said, I started off by thanking the Minister, and I know exactly where she's the path that she's had to take on this legislation. And at the end of the day, the UK Government have not accounted or legislated for the dogs being brought to Scotland or elsewhere, and we have, particularly Scotland, and we have seen that happen. I was aware of press articles and the like, seeing large numbers of XL bullies being brought into Scotland, and therefore I think that we have been ultimately pushed into a corner where I feel today that I will support this legislation, but I wanted to make it very clear and put on the record that I think that we have been pushed into this position rather than, and I know the Minister is not quite saying that, but I feel that I want to say it. I feel that we've been pushed into this position because the loopholes were not closed, and I do not think that, from what I've heard from the animal welfare organisations who have been in touch, and those, including those in my constituency, that it will make the situation safer, and in fact it's going to create a whole host of other issues up and down the UK, including perhaps animal welfare concerns when people decide not to get the licence and other issues that I know other members may come to speak about. But I do want to end, I don't have a particular question, as I said, I do want to end by thanking the Minister again. I think that I know that my constituents really feel listened to by the meeting that we had. I've had feedback from them. I feel that they really feel that you get the concerns and that you are listening to them and will find a way through this. But I think that, I'm in the position now where I realise and accept that we've got no choice but to bring in this legislation this time.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Sharon Dowie, followed by Russell Finlay. Oh, beg your pardon.
Oh, sorry, thank you. I was just going to come back to Mr McGregor, if I could. Firstly, this was never a constitutional issue. This was about good legislation. And as you know, legislation was announced with no consultation with the Scottish Government and no background moving forward with it. So it has been accelerated to where we are today. But just one thing I'd like to say to Mr McGregor is that initially the UK Government did estimate there'd be 10,000 dogs on the list. As at present, it's nearly 61,000. Out of those 61,000, there's only 200 that have chosen not to keep their dogs. So the majority of dog owners are responsible dog owners, and I'm confident and hopeful that will happen in Scotland as well.
Okay, thank you. Sharon Dowie and then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Good morning. So the UK Government announced the ban in September and it came into force in December 2023. Why has it taken the Scottish Government so long to implement what effectively seems to be the same ban?
Okay, if I may, can I just go through the timescale here? Because I think it's really important that we're very clear on how all this happened. On the 15th of September, the UK Government did publicly announce that they were going to bring in an XL bully ban in England and Wales. There was no consultation with the Scottish Government. On the 15th of September, the Prime Minister announced he'd ordered a DEFRA to undertake the work to define and ban XL bully dogs in England and Wales because the XL bully dog was not a breed that was recognised by the main British dog associations or the Kennel Club. So DEFRA convened an expert group to specify a legal definition of the XL bully for the purpose of the ban in England and Wales, and that met for the first time on the 21st of September 2023. So the regulations and the legislation for the ban and the detail were not available in early September because the detail was just being planned as of the 21st of September. On the 29th of September, I did receive a letter from the UK government advising they would be putting in a ban in England and Wales, but giving no timescale or any detail. And then on the 2nd of October, the Dog Control Coalition organisations that were set up in the DEFRA group, the RSPCA, the Scottish SPCA, British Veterinary Association, Kennel Club, Blue Cross, Dogs Trust and Battersea, all withdrew from the Prime Minister's DEFRA group due to concerns on the rushed legislation. On the 31st of October, the UK government publicly announced the timescale, being 8 weeks before they implement the not being able to give away XL bully dogs and having to be muzzled and on a lead by the 31st of December, which would be an 8 week period. On the 9th of November, I sent a letter to the UK government saying that we would not be following the same legislation and timescale. I didn't say we won't be following it. It was a timescale because at that stage we had 6 weeks to get things in place by the 31st of December. And then, then on the 14th of December, I'd also had a letter to my original query because I was asking the UK government about the potential loopholes with this legislation and the consequences in Scotland. And on the 14th of December, I finally received a response from the UK government with a very vague answer. And at that stage is when we decided, after Christmas, to bring in the legislation at pace.
OK, thank you. So you mentioned that you'd received letters. So in a letter from Michael Gove, MP, he warned that Scotland could become a dumping ground for the XL bullies and raised concerns that it had not yet been possible to secure equivalent protections in Scotland. So my question was, what engagement did you have then with the UK government? How many meetings, phone calls? And just to go back on a couple of things you just mentioned there, you'd said about the announcement on the 15th of September, and that there had been no communication with the Scottish Government. I'm under the impression that on the 15th of September, when they made the announcement, that UK officials on that day were in contact with Scottish Government officials as well. And you'd also mentioned about the 21st of September was the first meeting of the working group. But again, I'm under the impression that Scottish Government officials were actually part of that working group, and they actually came up and helped with the definition of the confirmation of the dog. So you're saying that you've had no communication, but I'm under the impression Scottish Government officials were actually involved from the day of the announcement. And on the letters that you've actually received, every letter asked for meetings with the Scottish Government and for use to be involved, because they actually wanted it to be a joint approach so that there wasn't any of these loopholes that you're talking about. And I'm also under the impression that the loopholes created because there has been no engagement from the Scottish Government with the UK Government on it. So because there's no legislation in Scotland, that's actually what's created the loophole. So it's because we've not put the legislation in at the same time.
Thank you. If I can just one point regarding that, I think the letter from Michael Gove was addressed to the DFM. I was CC'd into that one, and that was sent on the 13th of November. So the timescale from September to the 31st of December is a very short period of time to get legislation in place. I do know, and I will bring in Jim here, because he has been involved in the discussions with the UK government from the beginning, because the devolved administrations have been having discussions with them.
Yeah, thanks very much, Minister, and appreciate the question from the member. Just to stress that the first time that we actually were made aware of the UK government's decision to bring in these new controls on XL bully dogs was actually on the BBC News website. So there was no kind of prior knowledge or heads up that this was actually coming down the track. I must stress that we regularly engage with DEFRA officials on a range of dog control policy issues. As you quite rightly pointed out, did have a presence on, it was the UK government-led expert group that was designed to try and develop at rapid pace the confirmation standard. Myself and Andrew Vost from Scottish Government Animal Welfare were observers on that group, and that was obviously with a view to try and provide support to UK government with the confirmation standard. But just to stress that we have and continue to have weekly engagement with, at official level with DEFRA officials, and that was to work through the mechanics of how they were actually planning to develop the policy in relation to exile bully safeguards. The concerns that were raised at official level around the territorial extent of the provisions that were being brought through statutory instruments. That's why the Minister had actually written to, at the time, Lord Bennion to raise concerns that we felt there was an issue in terms of, you know, owners that could evade the law by simply transporting dogs to Scotland with no consequence. So just to stress, there has been regular engagement with DEFRA officials. That still continues. We meet every Friday to discuss a range of issues, and not just in relation to exile bully dogs, but in terms of wider, you know, potential wider reforms around dog control more generally.
Can I, so there's been regular weekly meetings between the Scottish Government officials. How many meetings has the Minister had with the UK Government?
I haven't had any meetings with the UK Government, but I've had many meetings since November with stakeholders and with Jim on a weekly basis, who's kept me updated on all progress.
Can I ask why you've not had any UK Government meetings?
I just haven't. No, there hasn't been on the agenda. I've been meeting with stakeholders.
It's obviously it's a really important subject, obviously, for a lot of people, especially people that own XL bullies. So did you not think it would be quite good to have a meeting with the ministers to ask the rationale behind
that? Well, I felt confident, to be honest, on the 14th of November, after the announcement on the letter that I received on the 9th, I didn't think we would be able to get the legislation in place. I didn't feel comfortable, to be honest, getting the legislation at speed in place for the 31st of December. And we also have in Scotland, which is unique to England and Wales, dog control notices through local authorities that have the powers to muzzle and to insist dangerous dogs are on a lead. And on a weekly basis, Jim does update me on those figures, and there's currently 1,200 dogs on that. So on the mid-November, I felt confident engaging with the stakeholders that we had these safety guards already in place in Scotland come the 31st of December that weren't in place in England and Wales, and that we were protected for community safety from dangerous dogs.
Okay. She's just saying six weeks is a tight timescale, but we're asked to be putting this in less than 4 weeks.
If we've got time, there's quite a lot of interest, so I will come back to you, Sharon. If I can bring in Russell Finlay and then Colin McNeill.
Thanks, Convener. Now, the reason, of course, for these controls being brought into place is public safety after a spate of horrific attacks, some of which were fatal, some of which involved children. And our thoughts are with all of those who've been harmed in these attacks and lost their lives. We welcome wholeheartedly the Scottish Government finally coming to the right decision. And I'd like to know, was this a case of spectacular poor judgment, dithering, or simply an opportunity to seek divergence with the rest of the UK?
I would say neither of the suggestions. As I've already said earlier, this has been ongoing for several months now. I have been engaging significantly with all stakeholders regarding this. It did come into place, I think, over the Christmas period, where we did see pretty much on social media incidents of XL bully dogs being brought up to Scotland, and also after the UK Government could not confirm whether or not that would be illegal.
Weeks, if not months, the Scottish Government were warned by the UK Government, by politicians in the Scottish Parliament, by the media, by experts, that this was an inevitable consequence of the rest of the UK legislation. Now, you said in your opening statement that dog attacks are rare, but there have been two XL bully attacks in Scotland within the past month, one of which was just 3 days ago. In both those attacks, people were harmed. In both those attacks, they were so serious, Police Scotland had to use firearms to kill the animals. And reportedly, both of these dogs came from elsewhere in the UK. Do you not, therefore, regret acting quicker?
No, I think if I could just say, firstly, regarding the incident in East Kilbride on Sunday, this is a very distressing incident, and my thoughts are for the victims of the dog attack. And I'd like to thank Police Scotland, who attended this incident and swiftly ensured the incident was brought under control. This is a live case, and members will appreciate that I can't discuss any details of the specific incident, and in line with standard operating practice, the use of a firearm by an officer will be assessed by the police investigation and the review commissioner. And I understand that the breed of dog is still yet to be confirmed, and also the incident that you're referring to in Hamilton, they could not determine the breed as well. And this is one of the issues with the stakeholders with the DEFRA Club, is identifying the breed. It was one of the challenges.
You and your officials have also talked about the system in Scotland of dog wardens, which are controlled by local authorities. I think in your answer a moment ago to my colleague Sharon Dow, you mentioned there being 1,200 dogs subject to dog control notices. Do you happen to know how many dog wardens there are in Scotland?
Every local authority should have a dog warden.
Right. But they don't, that's the problem, I think.
Well, it's up to local authorities, because every local authority does have the obligation to have a dog warden, and right. I know some local authorities, such as Perth and Kinross, have...
Well, they're an exception, and we did our own research. We asked all 32 councils, and we've received answers from around half of them. But taking Aberdeenshire, Western Bartonshire, East Ayrshire, Scottish Borders, Inverclyde, they all just have one each. Right. Like Manorshire Council has 0.2 of a dog warden, which I'm assuming is one dog warden working one day per week. And Glasgow, despite its size and population, has one dog warden. Realistically, there's no way on earth, especially in the face of Scottish Government cuts to local authorities, that they're going to increase these numbers anytime soon. And they're not well placed to actually deal with the dogs that are under control, the 1,200 dogs.
Yes, if I could just say, I do have the stats of dog control notices, just for a little bit of context there as well. Fife Council, for example, have 188 on the dog control notices. You've got Aberdeen that have got 56. So the local authorities are using the dog control notices. And I understand your point about local authorities, but we have set up an implementation forum, and we will be discussing this with local authorities and also COSLA and Police Scotland to consider any enforcement and operational issues that arise from this legislation, and it will help to inform consideration of any requests for additional funding.
Sure, but the dog wardens that exist are already insufficient. Do you not agree?
No, I do not agree.
One for the whole of Glasgow is all that's needed.
It would be up to each local authority to determine how many dog wardens they need. I'm sure local authorities might politically prioritised to have more dog wardens. It's up to each local authority.
Okay, thank you.
I beg your pardon, Pauline McNeill and then Katie Clark.
Thank you. Good morning. So the SSIs that we're considering this morning, is the purpose purely to close the loophole? Or I was listening to what Jim Wilson was saying, trying to understand. So there was discussion already with the UK government about XL Bullies policy, and that's what those DEFRA talks were about. So I was just trying to establish why you brought the regulations now. Is it just because you were having those discussions, now they see the loophole, so you want to close the loophole? Would that be right?
Yes, we wanted to bring the legislation in at pace due to XL Bullies being brought up from England and Wales.
But the working group, Jim, that you were talking about was around the policy of how to tackle XL Bully dogs, is that right? I understood that.
No.
Right, okay.
I mean, it was just to separate these things out. So the engagement with officials at DEFRA in the main was to actually look at the new controls that would be considered and introduced in England and Wales, and ultimately we were able to feed in our kind of perspective and views on that. But there have been separate Scottish Government-led working groups that have been established to look at opportunities for reform. That includes looking at improvements to enhance and strengthen the control of dogs legislation. There have been engagements to actually look at the 1991 legislation, the Dangerous Dogs Act. That was a separate Scottish Government-led group. And as part of it's not just at ministerial level, but the engagement that we've had with a range of stakeholders has been significant.
So the DEFRA expert group, Scotland was feeding in to what you already knew was the English, the planned English legislation on XL Bully Dogs, or...
The expert working group was designed and led by DEFRA, and it was only in place for a very, very short space of time, a few weeks, and that was with the primary focus to develop a confirmation standard the more, dare I say, routine engagements on a weekly basis were to actually have some policy conversations around the actual new safeguards that were being considered and developed.
Of XL bully dogs?
Yep.
Right. And then Scotland was doing its own work as well, separate from that, you said?
Yep. So there's completely separate strands in terms of the engagement that we're having with Scottish stakeholders around policy, not just in relation to XL bullies.
I'm just getting my head around this. So you knew that England was planning to ban XL bully dogs from that expert working group?
Well, the expert working group had been convened after the Prime Minister had made the announcement.
After, right, okay.
Didn't have any advance notification that this was actually coming down the track.
I'm just trying to... So, in my own mind, I just want to understand the timetable. Okay. So, Minister, you confirmed that the purpose of these regulations is to close the loophole. That's the real purpose.
Initially, yes. So, this is the first one. There will be the second SSI that will be...
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about that. Okay. Are you concerned about the definition of an XL bully dog? And because you've said that they can't confirm the two incidents we know about, whether it is the breed or not. And also, under the regulations, who would decide, who makes the decision finally as to who what is an XL bully dog breed?
That's been one of the concerns that's been raised with me from all stakeholders, because I think the definition that was determined by DEFRA is the male has to be 20 inches and the female has to be 19 inches. So you could have an XL bully, for example, that's 16 inches or 17 inches that would not have to wear a muzzle and a lead. So this has caused quite a lot of confusion down south when they implemented this, and the UK government said, if you've got any doubts, just register. I think what we've found as well over the correspondence that I've received, and I know that Jim's received, is there is confusion out there in the general public. And one of the things that we are keen is to learn lessons on how we can do it better than it has been raised. So this legislation, so we've got to the 31st of July, that we'll be putting support and help on the Scottish Government website to help people determine whether or not they've got an XL bully. I don't know if you want to bring it, say anything more.
Yeah, just to add to the Minister's comments, I would agree that the confirmation standard has triggered quite a lot of concern. You know, I'm receiving many letters from concerned owners that might be unsure as to whether they actually have an XL bully type dog or not. Ultimately, the confirmation standard is for, and the onus will be on owners when they're going through that exemption process. Now, the exemption process will be laid out in a second Scottish statutory instrument that will explain how owners actually engage with the exemption process, what they need to do, when they need to do it. But this is kind of a move away from kind of normal policy. So if we park XL bullies for just a second, if you, let's just say, had a pit bull type that's been seized by the police, the owner is then arrested, potentially under offences committed under the Dangerous Dogs Act 1991. If the dog in question doesn't present a risk to public safety, it would still be possible on the direction of the court to actually consider, for the owner to then consider going for an exemption, and there could be an assessment that would be conducted by an expert to determine whether the actual dog in question is actually a prohibited type of dog. But similar to what the UK government have done through DEFRA, it's an owner-led process for this exemption period that, I mean, ultimately we have to have, and details will be in the regulations, but we will have to obviously have a Scottish exemption scheme, which obviously the statutory instrument paves the way for that. But we need to be mindful that we're doing as much as we can to try and mitigate any issues and ensure that owners, when they are writing to the government, are pointed towards information that will be on the Scottish Government website that's to support owners through the process.
Thank you. So the purpose of the SSI is to set out the conditions of keeping an XL bully dog. But as you mentioned, the exemptions, we won't see that order until much later in the year. And I was a wee bit concerned about that, with the separation of the SSI considered today, where we can't see what the exemptions are. Maybe you could explain that. Thank you.
Yeah,
I'm happy, Jim, because you know the time scale. It's not going to be later in the year.
I'm happy to step in and cover that point. Yeah, just to stress that in terms of the regulations that have been developed, not just for this statutory instrument that's been considered today, but for the second statutory instrument, that is well underway. I mean, my team have worked at rapid pace to develop the draft regulations. I mean, ultimately, ministers have to consider the draft regulations before they're ultimately laid in Parliament. But just to give a sense of kind of timings, we are aware of the need to act quickly around the exemption process, because if we rewind from the designated date when this full regime will kick into play, which is the 1st of August, so the exemption process will close on the 31st of July, but we're trying to create a bigger window for owners to have the time to consider what they want to do. You know, do they want to actually retain their dog and go through an exemption process? We're also mindful about the significant impact on animal welfare, rehoming centres. We've had engagements with many, many stakeholders, including Edinburgh Cat Dog Home, who have been quite rightly stressing that there is clearly an increase in demand on services. So, but we are looking at a provision within these regulations that gives rehoming centres the opportunity to actually seek exemption for dogs that were actually within their care. So, obviously, the timings of the statutory instrument, all I can say is that it is coming down the track quickly. So I know
Under the pressure you must be under, but maybe understand my concern. So what would be the basis of the exemptions then? Because I don't think you can separate out the SSI today and the exemptions. So what's included in the exemptions then?
Yeah, so there's other conditions that are built into the exemption process. So there must be a requirement for third-party liability insurance, for example. That is a condition. There will be the requirement, and you can kind of tie up this particular SSI with the second SSI. So a condition is that the dogs must be muzzled in a public place, must be on a lead in a public place. There will be a requirement ultimately to ensure that any changes of circumstances are notified to Scottish Government. We are mindful of one of the, and I call it an unintended consequence, it's an issue that UK Government and Scottish Government are looking at. But what happens if you have someone who is the owner of an exorbitant dog and they, you know, they sadly pass away? So we need to look at, in very limited circumstances, the opportunity for the dog to be transferred to someone else. I mean, the details will be contained within the regulations as to how we are going to achieve that policy aim. But yeah, it's a policy that's been worked up at rapid pace. And just building on from the Minister's comments around the need to consider any implementation issues, the implementation group that's been established has representatives from Police Scotland, COSLA, the National Dog Warden Association Chair, the Society of Chief Health Environmental Officers in Scotland to manage dog warden services within local authorities. Now, these conversations will be scheduled on a fortnightly basis, but with the opportunity to consider any emerging issues on an urgent basis. And Minister, you've written to Councillor Chalmers from COSLA to seek a discussion or to open up the chances of a conversation to consider any impact on local authorities, not just Police Scotland, because we recognise that local authorities could be dealt with increasing levels of calls coming in if a member of the public suspects that there might be an exo bully that they've seen in public. It's not on a muzzle, it's not on a lead. So where are they going to turn to? Are they going to phone the police or are they going to phone local authorities? So there is just that, just to stress, there is ongoing engagement with a range of key stakeholders around these.
Just as you've answered my question about how you define an exo bully, just finally, some organisations have written to the committee with concerns. One of the concerns that concerns me is puppies that haven't reached the full grown size of their breed. Will you consider how that will be dealt with?
Can I just going back to the comment before, and I will address that, just to clarify, when the legislation was brought in for the 1st of February in England and Wales, one of the unintended consequences, as Jim has said, is about the issue if someone dies, what do you do with it? So this is where we're looking at a timescale, which is a little bit longer, being able to adapt all these unintended consequences into the second SSI, which the UK government are now adding in hindsight, because it was quite rushed through. And just going forward regarding puppies, for example, and we are engaging with stakeholders regarding these issues moving forward for SSIs.
Yeah, just to add to that, if I'll be brief, Convener, the regular engagements that we have with the Dog Control Coalition, which includes the major kind of animal welfare stakeholders such as Dogs Trust, SSPCA, RSPCA, Battersea, Blue Cross and others. One of the issues that's been raised with the Minister and with me at official level has been the concerns around neutering requirements, because of if you have a young dog, it's suggested that it would be not wise to get dogs neutered at a certain age. So we've taken into account concerns from animal welfare stakeholders around the neutering process, and you know, we think we've come up with a proportionate response to tackle those concerns that will be set out in the regulations still to come.
Thank you.
Thank you. Katie Clark and then John Swinney.
Thank you. Minister, you've clearly been watching what's been happening down south, and it's clear that there has been a number of problems there. The ban and reforming has had an impact in particular on vets and others at rehoming centres who've been put in a position of being obliged to destroy healthy dogs that come into their care after the rehoming deadline. And we're also told that there's been difficulties in establishing muscle training at short notice, and the veterinary sector are saying that they lack sufficient capacity to carry out all the required neutering. So given all the very practical issues that we've already seen in England and Wales, and given that you say that you've already had many meetings with stakeholders in Scotland, are you envisaging similar problems in Scotland after this order comes into effect later this week, if we vote for it?
I thank Ms. Clark for that. I have been engaging with stakeholders, and I am aware of all these concerns, and we have been engaging with stakeholders in Scotland as well. I'm envisaging that hopefully that we won't have these problems that are happening in England and Wales, because we are engaging with stakeholders moving forward, trying to bring the legislation in. But Jim, I don't know if you want to come in there.
Yeah, that's a really good point, because we need to obviously think through the consequences of the policy. What does that really mean for stakeholders? But you know, we've had and continue to have weekly engagements with Dog Control Coalition, which does include British Veterinary Association representation. I think that the key thing for us...
with what's about to happen, well, given you've had all these meetings, you must... That's a very basic question, isn't it?
Yeah.
Are you assured that everything's going to be OK in Scotland, or do you think there will be problems?
No, I think that there is a potential for problems. I think that we have to recognise that there is a strain on the system in terms of when people need to undertake certain conditions if they wish to obtain an exemption certificate. I mean, statistically, we've had conversations with DEFRA analysts around, and Minister's already pointed out, you know, a significant number of exemption applications that were submitted. What was interesting in terms of the pressures on capacities across vets, practices across the UK, is that I think the figure was 62% of exorbitantly dogs had not been neutered, so which is quite high. So, of course, that does place strain on services when there was a requirement in what was a 2.5-month window for the exemption process for owners in England and Wales. So their exemption process in England and Wales opened up mid-November. Can't remember the exact date, apologies. And it ran through to the 31st of January. What we're looking to try and do in Scotland is create a longer time frame for that exemption process to ease the strain on vets and others.
So in terms of timetable, just to be clear, the order, if it's passed, would come into effect on the 23rd of February, but from the 1st of August, it would be an offence. So could you just clarify that in terms of the timetable of, you know, law-abiding citizens being in a position where they would be guilty of an offence? When would that impact?
So the second one will become a first for the 1st of August. We will be laying the second SSI very shortly, and that will be giving all the timescale and details in that. If I could just come back to Ms. Clark, just one detail that you that might give you a little bit of confidence from this engagement that we've had down south that I did say to Mr. McGregor was, out of the 61,000 that registered in England and Wales, only 200 decided to investigate to not keep their XL bully. So the majority of XL bully dog owners are responsible. So that's where it's sort of given me confidence that there won't be the pressures on the vets as predicted with the high numbers that have been registered.
So the order is, you know, that's been put in front of us is very short, astonishingly yep. short. Can we just confirm exactly what's going to be happening later this week? So later this week, the safeguards relate to designated dogs would require to be kept in a muzzle and on a lead. Beyond that, is anything happening later this week, or will it be on the 1st yep. of August?
No, just clarify
that.
As of today, the 23rd, on the first SSI, having an XL bully in dog in public, you'll need to have a lead and on a muzzle. Breeding from, you're yes. not allowed to breed, you're not allowed to sell an XL bully dog, abandon an XL bully dog or let it stray or give away an XL bully dog. So that's all included in this SSI.
And if you were to say breed or give away, you would be would be committing a criminal offence.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Just enough.
So the problem with this, obviously, is that the insufficient clarity about what an XL bully dog is. And we are being asked to vote on a very, very short order. Is there any definition within there? And do you not think parliamentarians should have some kind of definition before voting?
The definition is on the UK government website, which we are following.
So you're mirroring the definition.
Yes, yes. If we didn't mirror, the loophole would be reopened.
Apologies, convener, come in just on the point around Ms. Clark raised the point around kind of penalties. It might be useful just to explain that.
I think you've covered it, actually. I think that's fine. The other issue I was going to ask, so you think it's clear in terms of because you're saying it's the UK government website, that but in terms of younger dogs, because there's been an issue around about that, can you refer me also to any definitions in relation to that? Because that's clearly been a very live issue down south.
It is a live issue down south, and I think we need to be mindful that the approach that was adopted and run with by UK government through DEFRA and a similar approach through Scottish government will urge a precautionary approach. The difficulty is that it's very, very difficult to type a dog when it is young, when it's a puppy. So we do recognise that. Mm-hmm. There may not be any papers that suggest that a person actually owns an XL bully type dog. The UK Kennel Club don't have this as a recognised...
Understand what the definition that will come into effect later this week. We've got to look at a UK website. That's where we look for that. Or it's going to be the Scottish Government website. And in terms of the guidance regarding young dogs, is there going to be anything in place later this week? Or do we have to wait for later for that? So that the owners know what to do, that people that are, citizens know what
my understanding is
to do.
If you would be looking at the definition on the website as is, the male has to be 20 inches and the female has to be 19 inches. So I would say a puppy at that stage would not reach that.
Okay, thank you.
John Swinney.
Thank you, Kavir. I wonder if I could just get confirmation that the first the Scottish Government knew of a United Kingdom Government proposal for an XL bully dog ban was via the BBC News website on the 15th of September. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yep.
Can I ask the Minister if that is the type of notification the Scottish Government would believe is consistent with the intergovernmental frameworks that are supposed to operate between the four administrations of the United Kingdom?
Yes, I do not believe that that the Scottish Government finding out by BBC News is the right way for the UK Government to be treating devolved nations in decisions such as this.
Does that highlight a fundamental lack of respect for the role of the Scottish Government and the legislative responsibilities of the Scottish Parliament?
Yes, in a way. I don't know if it's totally intentional or it was just disregarded to tell the Scottish Government, but it would have been ideal if there was communication prior to the announcement.
I find it very strange that this was announced on the 15th of September and the first formal notification in writing to the Scottish Government advising of a ban was on the 29th of September, 14 days after the BBC News website. Is that an indication of respectful behaviour by the United Kingdom Government?
I don't believe so. And if I may just also say to Mr. Swinney, we did find out about the UK government publicly announcing the timescale and the detail on the 31st of October, and I wasn't made aware formally until a letter was sent on the 9th of November.
I'm grateful to the Minister for indicating another example of a lack of respect from the United Kingdom government and a lack of respect and obligation to pursue the intergovernmental arrangements which this Parliament is assured are in operation, but clearly on this issue have not in any shape or form been respected. Is that a fair summary?
I would say that's a fair summary.
Now, I'm interested in, obviously, there has been engagement. I can clearly understand from Mr. Wilson's contribution there is detailed Scottish Government official engagement on many of these questions in relation to dog control. Therefore, after this public announcement and inappropriate intergovernmental communication from the United Kingdom Government, the Scottish Government then sought to understand the implications of that legislation for Scotland to determine whether or not there would be loopholes or whether the existing dog control legislation in Scotland would suffice. Would that be a fair summary of what was going on between the 15th of September and what I think is the formal response to the Scottish Government on the 14th of December, of giving the information that might allow the Scottish Government to form an informed view about whether or not there were loopholes?
Yes, I think you're correct, Mr. Swinney. From day one, I think, and I will bring in Jim because he has been in the conversations with the DEFRA group that has been set up, and we've been trying to establish, ever since this was announced, the consequences for Scotland with this UK legislation coming in England and Wales. And I did write in my letter to ask formally again, and then you're right, we didn't get a response until the 14th of December, and it was very unclear and vague. Did you want to come in?
Just to come in on the back of the Minister's comments. I think one of the key concerns from a policy-making perspective was around the lack of an evidence base around the risks caused by XL bully dogs in Scotland. Prior to the 15th of September last year, there was not one Scottish stakeholder that was kind of banging down the door saying, you need to act, you need to actually introduce safeguards on these dogs. I've become slightly obsessed with the dog control notice statistical information that comes in on a weekly basis that tells me how many dog control notices have been served and which types of dogs were actually at the heart of the notice that's been served. XL bully dogs have been floating about the top 10. They're kind of number 10 on the list at the moment. So there are other breeds of dogs that, on paper, when you look at a dog being out of control, that are causing more issues for local authority dog wardens. But Minister and I have met with local authority representatives to try and get a sense of how much of an issue is this in Scotland. Now, the concerns that we're beginning to kind of build around the XL bully dogs has, of course, been triggered by some horrific incidents, and I absolutely accept that these are horrendous incidents, in some cases tragedies, that have occurred as a consequence of a dog being dangerously out of control. But as policymakers, we need to try and think about the opportunity to make evidence-based policy-making decisions. So the dog control notice regime is something that I think the Scottish Parliament should be proud of, but I do think there's opportunities for us to try, once the dust has settled on XL bully safeguards, is to think about the challenges around responsible dog ownership and with a focus on the actual deed, not the breed.
Can I pursue you further on that, Mr. Wilson? I assume that in advance of the 15th of September and this announcement, that type of activity that you've just placed on the record of officials within the Scottish Government and ministers exploring what is the, if I might call it, the ideal regime for dog control within Scotland is something that you are regularly and assiduously considering, and in actual fact, we're considering in dialogue with DEFRA officials in the United Kingdom government as well.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, we've had some conversations with DEFRA officials around some of the work that was undertaken by my team that was looking at the operational effectiveness of the Control of Dogs legislation. Of course, that was subject during the last parliamentary term to some scrutiny by the Public Audit Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee. So we were aware that there was a need to respond to that, and it was a helpful report. We responded to a number of the recommendations quickly. But we also recognised that, you know, at official level, DEFRA officials were already kind of looking at, it was a research report by the University of Middlesex, London, that looked at a whole host of issues around responsible dog ownership. So these conversations have been in play for many, many years. And I suppose in relation to the point, Mr. Swinney, around the need to try and have, I suppose, a holistic look at what is it we're going to do that will be that will make a difference in terms of reducing the amount of incidents, irrespective of breed. These conversations have been taking place over many, many months and, in fact, years. Of course, there is a need to think about opportunities for wider reform. That would require primary legislation. But certainly something that the Minister and I are regularly, at least, well, it feels like weekly at the moment, but there's regular discussions about opportunities for wider reform going forward.
Thank you for that. My last question, Convener, is on the position the Scottish Government finds itself in now, with essentially a lack of clarity arising out of the legislation that has been enacted in England and Wales, creating a problem in Scotland. Is that a fair representation of the challenge that the Scottish Government now faces, given the fact that Mr Wilson has just placed on the record there has been regular work to ensure the dog control regime in Scotland is as appropriate and robust as it can be, subject, of course, to further legislative change? But what has precipitated the necessity of this order coming to the government today is the lack of clarity created by the legislation implemented in England and Wales.
I would say that is correct. I think it's at the speed as well that concerned us, because when it was announced on the 31st of October, the first stage was the 31st of December, and then they had to the 31st of January to register for the exemption. So there have been unintended consequences since then, such as what happens if someone dies and they've got an XL bully, which we're now dealing with through the second SSI, which the UK government are now having to deal with. So because it was rushed through legislation, we are trying to pick up where we are now. We are hoping to implement it better than it has been done in England and Wales.
There are actually now further implementation issues arising in England and Wales as a consequence, yes, of the way in which the United Kingdom government has handled this?
There has been, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Rona Mackay.
Thank you. I'll be brief. Convener, good morning. I just wanted to say, so I've been listening very carefully to the points raised today. And, you know, I wonder if the Minister would agree with me that given the actions of the UK government, not to introduce this legislation would have much more serious consequences, you know, If we have been pushed into a corner. We have to introduce this, and it's necessary. Would the Minister agree with that?
I would. I think, as I've said, this isn't a decision that we've taken lightly. I think we have been put into this position. It's not the road that the Scottish Government would like to go. We know it's deed, not breed. And I think we also need to be clear also. I know that there was a horrific incident down in Essex after the UK government implemented this legislation where a woman was killed. Now, that dog attack happened in a home, and a lot of dog attacks actually do happen in a home. So even this legislation is to have them in muzzles and leads outside and bring in safeguards, which is a public safety, is paramount here. We also have to acknowledge responsibility of dog ownership, and we're trying to find the balance here.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Before I bring in other members, I wonder if I can maybe just touch on the point that you made about the stakeholder forum. So in terms of going forward with this issue, you've clearly indicated that you've had extensive engagement with stakeholders, and we all know that one of the particular issues that they have raised is around the timescales for the constraints, such as muzzling in particular, to be rolled out, and the difficulties that will that can cause for owners. So, can I ask if the stakeholder forum will look to address some of the concerns that have been raised, in particular by stakeholders? But what is the purpose of the forum going forward?
Yes, absolutely. So before the legislation was put, the negative SSI was put in place, I have had extensive engagement with stakeholders since November, and now I am meeting. I met last week with the National Dog Warden Association, which has a variety of stakeholders there, and I'm due to meet them every month moving forward. I'm very keen to continue to engage with stakeholders. This might not be an ideal situation for them, but to learn lessons and see how we can implement this legislation with stakeholders in mind as well, and I know that they are assisting us with the secondary the legislation for the second SSI regarding neutering as well. So it's very important that we continue the engagement.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, I'm going to open it up to other members and invite Christine Graham if you would like to ask any questions.
Yes, thank you very much, and I thank interested in the committee questions. I just think this is a complete mess. We've had to ask questions because the law of itself is a mess. Can I just ask the Minister, you talked about a loophole, had there not been issues, and I've taken on board all the processes with the UK government, had there not been issues about a so-called, and I put in quotes, dumping, because I don't like the term, bully XL type dogs in Scotland, would the Minister have proceeded, as I think I've asked frequently, to take a good look at the Control of Dogs Scotland Act, of which I was the author, to see if that could be tightened up even more? And can I refer in particular, and I hope the committee is aware of this, of Section 9 of that Act, entitled Dangerous or Unresponsive Dogs. And this applies within the home, and as you rightly say, things happen within the home, attacks, but this applies within the home, these regulations adopted from the UK, if they are adopted today, do not apply in the home. This section applies when an authorised officer takes the view that a dog control notice here is not suitable. This has to go to court and let the court decide that this dog may or may not have to be put down or some other issue taken. It also gives the owner the right of appeal. And it's any dog. So, in fact, if there was any issue in Scotland with Bully XL's minister, would that not have been suitable to use that, had it not been the position about your concerns about excessive dogs coming up to Scotland?
Yes, I think one of the things that we had concerns about initially with the announcement of the ban down south was this loophole, which we were trying to get certainty on, which we didn't get until the 12th or the 14th of December, sorry, I can't remember the exact date now. And I think that was the reason that we did have concerns, and that's where I wrote my letter on the 14th of November. And I did feel confident at that stage that on the 31st of December, because we've got the dog control notices through the local authorities who have the powers to deal with dangerous dogs locally, that we were really in the same position as England and Wales. I think what we didn't envisage was people bringing up XL bully dogs during the Christmas period, and then obviously community safety has to be paramount, and this is why this decision's been made.
I'll come to that, but I should possibly have made the statement of my registered interest, as I'm a member of the SSPCA and a patron of the Edinburgh Dog and Cat Home, but I assure you I've come to this with an objective mind, I hope. Can I ask then, which organisations have opposed this regulation, these regulations coming in? Just to list them, if you would, Minister.
Yes, well, I think from my one of the initial questions where I said the groups from the UK government group that was set up.
In Scotland.
So, formally opposed, I'm going to bring Jim in here because there's so many and I don't think I've had it. There's concerns being raised, but not formally opposed.
Yeah, just, I mean, in terms of Scottish stakeholders, and just to provide a bit of context around what I'm about to say, we held some regional engagements in Helensburgh, Dundee, Galashiels, with a whole host of interested stakeholders. This was not just about Exeter Bully Dogs. This was around how local organisations, key stakeholders, can work better together.
I'm asking specifically about these regulations, because I know about meetings.
Comment on that. So I'll give an example. I've had regular conversations with SSPCA who do not support and like the policy. They understand why the decision is being made, but I think it's fair to say that that probably reflects the views of a number of welfare stakeholders that have a presence in Scotland, mainly through the Dog Control Coalition. They have kind of made similar points to the UK government when they were considering the controls that were going to be introduced in England and Wales. We have lots and lots of concerns that are raised around any moves that looks at breed-specific legislation, so that continues to be very contentious. So a number of Scottish stakeholders have been quite open and very honest about their views around the policy, which they do not like, but they understand that there's an opportunity to work with the Scottish Government to try and mitigate the impact of any unintended consequences as these safeguards are introduced.
As this regulation will enter into the ambit of the Dangerous Dogs Act 1991, what was the view of these organisations on the efficacy of the Dangerous Dogs Act 1991, which already has named breeds in it?
Yeah, so, I mean, I suppose the one key thing is that this is the first addition to the list of prohibited dogs in over 30 years. So it's certainly not a decision that's been taken or made lightly. I think the challenge that we have is that when we look at statistical information that comes in from Public Health Scotland, that tells me, information that's reported from local health boards, how many people have been admitted to hospital as a consequence of a dog bite or admitted to accident and emergency, the figures are concerning. So we recognise that...
I asked about the efficacy of that act.
Well, yeah, it's got many opponents. I think that we are in a position where any suggested reforms to the 1991 Act would need to be very, very carefully considered. I do not think that we are currently in a position that we're looking at any significant and fundamental changes to the policy under the 1991 Act. However, we are looking very seriously at the opportunities to strengthen and enhance the Control of Dogs Act legislation. But I don't know if the Minister wants to...
Yeah, absolutely. And as Ms Graham knows, that this has not been an easy decision or a decision that has been taken lightly. I don't like to go away from the deed, not breed, which the Scottish Government does support, but we find ourselves in this unique position that we have to do this because of community safety and the loophole that has been created by this legislation. But I know I've met with Ms Grant, and once all this legislation has gone through, I'm very keen to work together to see how that we can reform and strengthen your Dog Control Scotland Act as well moving forward.
We are looking at the consequences of some of this in England now. You mentioned 200 dogs. These dogs were put down. So in England, some 200 dogs have been put down by their owners, and they get money from the government to do it. What is the BVA's position on this? What are the vets' positions on this?
The vets have raised,
of vets is they don't like putting down
No, they don't. This is one of the concerns that has been raised at our stakeholders' engagement. I do not know after the 61,000 that have been registered and over 200 they've decided not to keep. I do not know specifically if they have all been put down. I don't know, Jim, if you know that detail.
Yeah, the compensation scheme, which will be form part of the second Scottish statutory instrument.
But as we're mirroring, I want
yeah,
to...
Yeah, and quite right to highlight the figures. So, you know, it's difficult to gauge how many Exeter Bully Dogs may be coming into that particular situation, if we can call it that, where for whatever reason the dog owner has decided that they do not want to apply for exemption certificate and they go down a different path. Mm-hmm. Just going back to the point around engagement that we've had with animal welfare stakeholders, they have quite fairly raised a number of concerns around the ethical and practical concerns that are being faced by vets who are being tasked in certain cases, and I appreciate the numbers are not huge, but that's still a high number of dogs that have been euthanised, that the concern is that they are ultimately dealing with a dog that they might deem to be perfectly well-behaved, it's not aggressive, and it's perfectly healthy. So I know that in context, 61,000 applications for exemption, over 200 for compensation. I don't know what the numbers will be for Scotland, because there is a large degree of uncertainty around the XL bully population. The figures that were quoted at the EFRA committee, the Commons EFRA committee on the 18th of October, which was a one-off evidence session on XL bully dogs, revealed that the number of XL bully dogs could be between anything between 50,000 and 150,000. Welfare stakeholders that I've engaged with have kind of offered a range in terms of what they think the figure could be, but there is a huge degree of uncertainty as to the actual population.
I'll just ask the final one, if I may, because I'll come to things in my... I hope we get to make a little submission at the end. Is that the huge problem here is saying XL bully type dog. Now, I've looked at the confirmation paragraphs. It's paragraphs. You'd need a PhD to work out if your dog was a bully XL type, if you didn't know its history. So I'm going to ask the Minister this. Do you have concerns? Because there's quite a lot of sensationalism round about this, and I want to look at this with a cool head for the sake of everybody. Yep. Eh? Appalled at attacks. Do you have concerns that members of the public will wrongly identify, if this goes through and people have to muzzle their dogs and leash in public places, that the public will wrongly identify a dog as an XL bully type, get onto the police or the local authority, big stramash locally in the community, and it turns out to be nothing of the kind, or has to be DNA tested?
I do have concerns. This has been raised with me from day one regarding the definition of an XL bully, and this is why we want to be very clear moving forward, especially on our Scottish Government website. The description is done to be able to support people to identify whether they have an XL bully or not. You're totally correct. It has been sensationalised. In the last couple of months, there have been newspaper articles and on television, and the XL bullies, supposed XL bullies, would not identify through the definition, the height. So I do think that this has caused confusion with the general public as well. So,
is it not a basic principle of law that it should be clear and understood, but not confused?
That's what we're trying to do through the Scottish website as we move forward with this legislation.
Well, Minister, I would challenge you that, and I'm not laying the fault here, we're replicating something in England, but what was wrong, it's wrong in England as well, by the way. It's bad law there, it's bad law here, if it comes into force, is that you cannot unravel this, because we come to the kernel of this, which is what is a bully XL, and nobody in this room can actually give a clear, simple definition. And that's key to any legislation, particularly when you're taking away people's rights, particularly when you're criminalising them, particularly when animals are going to be put down or dumped by people who don't do it. And it's for a few, not the many here, because there are many XL bullies in Scotland. So that's my huge concern about this, is that you cannot, because that's so bad, because the definition is not clear, it's bad law and cannot come into force, I hope, in Scotland.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Bob Dorris.
Good morning, Minister. Good morning, Mr. Wilson. I will be supporting government moves, but with not any great enthusiasm, based on a precautionary approach in relation to legislation, Convener. I have had a number of XL bully dog owners contact me, but also other concerned members of the public, so I've seen both sides of this debate from constituents who have made representations to me. But clearly dog and animal welfare groups and expert groups all withdrew from the DEFRA working group in England pursuing a ban due to concerns over the poor quality of that legislation and its rushed nature by the UK government. So it's clearly far from perfect. To call it imperfect would be a compliment, I think, to the UK legislation. So the Scottish legislation is going to have very similar issues, and it might be that weak legislation is better than no legislation based on the precautionary principle that I've mentioned. But I've got a constituent, Minister, who has got two XL bully type dogs, responsible owner, I'm sure. Through no fault of their own, they're going to have to move home. And they will have a situation where they will struggle, not because they've got an XL bully type dog, but because social landlords don't like taking dogs into tenancies, and neither do some private landlords. So they may have an invidious choice somewhere down the line in relation to their two dogs, to euthanise their dogs to prioritise a home. My understanding is this statutory instrument doesn't provide an exemption for my constituent, which is of concern, but there'll be a further statutory instrument coming down the line where exemptions will be being looked at. Is this something the Scottish Government can look at and will look at?
Thank Mr. Dorris for that. One of the things that is that has been raised by stakeholders as well, and you know about rehoming centres and maybe the possibility for allowing them to have the extension that they could rehome XL bullies. Unfortunately, in the circumstances that we currently find ourselves in, if that loophole was opened, then it would allow, again, dogs to be brought up to rehoming places to be distributed throughout Scotland. So that's something that we can look at with the implementation group, but I would have concerns. I don't know, Jim, if you want to come in on that.
Yeah, I do. Thanks, Minister. And it was something that was reflected on in terms of the fairly recent engagement with Mr. Dorris, Mr. McGregor and representatives from Bedley Gardens that the Minister and I engaged. The point, and it was really well made during that conversation around the challenges around unintended consequences when it comes to housing. So, you know, this is an issue that we're aware of because we've raised at official level with the UK government, DEFRA officials. I have seen some supportive messaging on certain council websites in England that have, you know, suggested that as long as the owners follow the process, they have the exemption certificate, and adhere strictly to the conditions, there would be no impact. But we do recognise that we need to work through what does this really mean for Scottish owners of XL bully dogs if they have any concerns around housing. So we have been in touch with Scottish Government housing policy to ensure that this is a live issue, that we are trying to look at ways to try and mitigate any issues that might arise from, you know, the new safeguards that are coming in. But it's a point really, really well made. I recognise that there are knock-on effects as a consequence of this policy on owners, and we're trying to do what we can to try and mitigate any issues that do arise.
Let's push a little bit more on this, Minister, in terms of where flexibility and discretion can be used and whether that can be described as a loophole, because I think they are two different things. If we define legislation tightly and do it well, it's not a loophole, it's appropriate flexibility and discretion. So, for example, if someone has a private tenancy and the landlord wishes to, in Scotland, all Scotland-based, and the landlord wishes to take possession of that home to stay in it themselves, and that individual becomes homeless through no fault of their own, that's all clearly evidence-based. That wouldn't be a loophole. That would be a very clear element of flexibility that could be shown. Now, I know you can't legislate for individual cases, Minister, but we should at least be looking to try to legislate along different themes. And I don't think if we legislate for housing situations in England, there's any way whatsoever that's a loophole for people bringing dogs from England to Scotland. I don't understand that. But I would maybe just ask a little bit more about how government will work with representatives of large dog breed owners, such as experts at Bedley Gardens, which Mr. Wilson mentioned, because the implementation group, I think COSLA, Police Scotland, National Association of Dog Wardens and others were mentioned. I'm not sure representative of large dog breed owners were mentioned as part of that implementation group. I think that would be a worthwhile endeavour. So rather than engaging with them, actually having them at the table would be a worthwhile endeavour also. So what the Minister thinks about that?
I think, Mr. Dorris, I think one of the things, as I've already mentioned earlier, that the unintended consequences of this legislation, the the issue with if someone dies, and for example, where does it excel bully? So these are things that are being considered, and as Jim's already outlined, that we will be considering moving forward. I do know we have the implementation group, and it could be very worthy consideration to include these groups. I don't know, Jim, your view on that?
No, I mean, the intention, and I made clear during the conversation with Bedley Gardens, that you know, we will continue to engage. I think that we need to be mindful that there is huge levels of stakeholder interest in this general policy going forward. And again, it's trying to work through any emerging issues or concerns and possible barriers to smooth implementation of these new safeguards, that we need to speak and continue to speak with a very, very wide range of stakeholder interests.
Final question, Convener. It's clear that there was ongoing dialogue with DEFRA already about wider reform in relation to dog control in Scotland, but also a potential pan-UK approach to that. Were representatives of large dog breed owners, have they been engaged in any of those discussions? Because myself and Mr McGregor, when we met with Bedley Gardens and the Minister and yourself, Mr Wilson, they were really up for reform of the system within Scotland. They really wanted to engage. They wanted to be challenged, but they wanted to innovate and really transform the system in Scotland. Their expertise is surely crucial in taking forward some much-needed reforms.
Absolutely, and I think one of the things as we move forward with after the dust settles and all of this is the reform regarding dangerous dogs, and also I'm very keen to work with Jim Fairley, who's the new Minister for Animal Welfare as well. So I know he's only just got into his role for a few days, but I will be having a meeting with him as soon as I can to see how we can work together moving forward. But I think you're totally right. I think moving forward, it's going to be very, very important that we engage with all stakeholders, including the groups that you deal with as well.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Okay, I'm aware of time. We have got a very full agenda today. However, I'm also aware that this is a very important issue and there is some significant public interest in it. So I'm going to open up to members if there are any final small supplementary questions that you would like to ask, then I'll bring you in. So Katie Clark, Russell Finlay.
Thank you. And my question relates to the formal status of the DEFRA guidance, which, of course, isn't referred to in the order. And the issue, of course, is the issue that Christine Graham was referring to about good law being clear law. And we can expect in the criminal courts that defence agents will be disputing whether a particular dog is or is not an XL bully, and will be arguing it isn't. Christine Graham referred to DNA testing. So could you maybe confirm exactly what the formal status of the DEFRA guidance is and whether the intention is to continue to rely on guidance of that nature once the second SSI comes forward, or whether there will be something more substantial put together, or how will that be clarified in terms of how the courts will interpret this legislation? So could you just clarify the formal status of the guidance?
Yes, thank you, Ms Clark. I think the UK government DEFRA guidance that came up with the group, which we know the stakeholders were not keen on and did remove themselves from the group, that is the guidance where, as I've already stated, the measurement guidance for the male and the female, and the measurements of being an XL bully on the website. And we have copied that through the Scottish Government website, but moving forward, we would like to be... Sorry.
Yes, I know we've got a short time. Yep. What is the formal status of it? Because in the courts, what approach will they take? And is this the strongest way to embed a legislation in law, or... It may be the official would want to come in on that.
Jim, you want to come in?
Yeah, I mean, the guidance is, I mean, ultimately a document that will be considered if someone was to, let's just say, appeal, if they were suggested that they were in possession of a prohibited type of dog and they disagreed. So, I mean, ultimately there will be cases once the full regime kicks into play on the 1st of August, that someone who may be going through a court process could challenge the fact that they don't think that there is that the dog in question is actually a prohibited type. But we, you know, similar to what UK government have done, and our position will be the same, is that there will be a reliance on guidance that has been developed for the confirmation.
Because England's obviously ahead of us in this.
Yep.
Do you know if there's any cases that have been taken?
There's one thing that I can say on that, because there will be, and it's something that you've had to obviously look at in terms of, well, what happens if it comes to light that someone seeks a specialist assessment and it turns out that the dog in question wasn't actually a prohibited type. So what DEFRA will need to then do, and what we would obviously want to consider, is that in terms of the exemption process, what would be the deregistration route in cases where it's maybe been legally challenged and the courts may have determined that...
I'm actually more concerned with the criminal courts and what is an offence and what isn't an offence, and how that... I want strong legislation that is easily interpreted by a court, and that's why I'm asking the question, that's why I'm asking, what is the status of this guidance? How will a court determine what is an XL bully dog and what isn't?
They would obviously have to look at the confirmation standard guidance that's been produced.
Okay, thank you.
Sharon Dowie, then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Can I just clarify something you said earlier on? There's groups, rehoming centres, that are concerned that come Friday they would need to get dogs put to sleep. But when you were talking earlier on, you'd said something about rehoming would be able to seek an exemption for those in their care. So does that mean that on come Friday, rehoming centres can still keep the dogs they've got, they wouldn't need to be put to sleep?
That's, well, ultimately, decisions on what rehoming centres do with dogs in their care will be up to them. But legally, what we have stressed in Scottish Government guidance is that the owners will be able to retain their dogs come 23rd of February. But the detail around the exemptions that would apply or can be used as part of the exemption process by rehoming centres will allow them legally to actually consider whether they want to retain and keep the dog in their care. So it's not an automatic put the dog to sleep, and we'll have stressed this. These are issues that we've discussed with Dog Control Coalition, with all the key welfare stakeholders that are clearly interested in what the Scottish Government's policy is going to be around the exemption process. But there will be, as we've heard earlier, that in cases in England and Wales, they did have over 200 applications for compensation which would have resulted in dogs being euthanised. So just to try and separate out the first stage of the safeguards produces the requirement for owners to ensure that their dogs are muzzled, kept on a lead in a public place. But further detail is to come down the track very, very quickly in terms of the second instrument that will detail what actually happens for those going through the exemption process and a compensation scheme as well. So, I mean, I know that regulations are at an advanced stage in terms of being drafted, so it'll be sooner rather than later, but I can't give a specific date as to when the regulations will be laid, because ultimately the Minister needs to consider and sign them off.
If I can just give a little bit of clarity there, I'm not sure if it was the unintended consequence of maybe somebody dying and then having an XL bully and then being able to rehome it. But as of this, I think the SPCA had 4 XL bullies in the last couple of weeks that they've been trying to rehome before this Friday, because they will have to adhere to the legislation that comes into place regarding rehoming.
Right. Okay. So in another question, go back onto my previous questions. I can understand that there is frustration if you heard about the implementation of the new legislation through the BBC, because I know from being in the Scottish Government it's very frustrating when you hear announcements through the BBC rather than through a ministerial statement in the Chamber. But can I just ask, you only wrote a letter to the UK Government on the 14th of November, but you've chose not to engage at all with the UK Government.
My officials have been engaging weekly, and I've been engaging with stakeholders since this was announced.
But you've engaged with stakeholders, but you've chosen not to engage at all with ministers in Westminster.
It wasn't that I chose not to specifically meet with them. I was getting updated on a weekly basis, and when I found out the legislation was going to be put in place in England and Wales, I had no detail of it. At that stage, I'd said to Jim, I want to meet all stakeholders now just to get the view on what's happening in the England and Wales. And I've lived, I've breathed, I've dreamt XL bully dog since last November. But it wasn't, I just didn't want to meet the UK government. I was just watching exactly what was happening and implementing it down south.
So I'm just wondering about the loophole, because again, that was highlighted that it could have been an issue. So if you'd engaged with the UK ministers, would you have expected the UK government to legislate for crimes that would potentially have been committed in Scotland? Because I would have thought that would have been under our remit.
Well,
At the moment, it would seem that if you rehome a dog, if you abandon a dog, if you don't register the dog, that's an offence in England and Wales. Mm-hmm. But I think they had said that if somebody then came to Scotland with their dog, it's not an offence in Scotland, so they couldn't legislate for that. So would you have expected England or the UK government to legislate for something that was in Scotland? Is that not why they were trying to engage with you, so that we could put something in place here?
Yeah, I think that was one of our concerns initially when the announcement was made. And I know, as Jim has been meeting with them on a weekly basis, was trying to get clarity regarding that. And they didn't come back saying, oh, we can't legislate in Scotland as such. When I got the letter on the 14th of December, it was very unclear and very vague as to the response that we'd been asking for months regarding that. So, no, I wouldn't be expecting the UK government to legislate for Scotland, but me not meeting UK government ministers was not intentional for any constitutional reason. It was just because I was looking at legislation, looking what's happening in Scotland and engaging with stakeholders and engaging with Jim on a weekly basis to be kept updated.
Okay, one final question. If you weren't concerned about the safety concerns when the UK government were putting in the legislation, what's changed between then and now for you to now be implementing the legislation? Do you have figures on how many dogs were actually getting brought across?
No, we don't. I think the only, as I've already reiterated, like I was confident when the legislation was announced on the 31st of October, but I was formally told in mid-November that through the dog control notices that we have in place through the local authorities, that would have the same safeguards in place for the 31st of December that England and Wales had in place. And when I was engaging even with stakeholders down south, they were wishing that they had DCNs in place in England and Wales, like Scotland does here. So I felt confident with that. I think one of the a point where serious consideration was taken was when we saw over the Christmas period, and we don't have any stats exactly on how many XL bullies were brought up, but we did see it on social media and for a community safety issue. But also, I have to say, an animal welfare issue for dogs just to be brought up in vans with no history, they don't know where they're going, into new households, that would cause anxiety. And so it was a considered option just that we had to move forward, primarily for community safety, but for animal welfare for the XL bully dogs as well.
Okay, so we don't have any figures at all. So we don't know if it's 10 dogs, 100 dogs, 1,000 dogs. We don't have anything at all.
No, it was all really just on social media, so it's very hard to collect data from social media. I don't know, Jim, if you've got any...
I'll be brief. There's simply no system of recording the data in terms of the movement of dogs between coming from England and Wales to Scotland, but we have noticed significant traffic on social media with cases that have been, whether it was on X or other social media platforms, that they were indicating that in some cases there would be individuals transporting large numbers of dogs without actually saying how many from England to Scotland. This kind of became a significant concern, especially after the festive break. So when that kind of milestone date for the UK government's policy that kicked in on the 31st of December, we were certainly seeing more and more traffic on social media and press reports about efforts to rehome a number of dogs and these dogs being brought to Scotland. But yeah, just going back to the point that Ms Dowie raises, that there's no kind of central recording system that would allow me to track movement of dogs from one country to another.
I'll need to move on. Okay. Thank you. Russell Finlay.
Thank you very much. Very quick question. Minister, today you've told us that there's been a lack of respect towards the Scottish Government, and I think we're perhaps slightly losing sight of what this is about. This is about preventing children, adults being maimed and killed by XL bullies. And surely you agree that public protection is paramount rather than seeking constitutional issues or bruised eagles within Scottish Government?
I don't agree with Mr. Findlay's perception of how things have come, but I do agree, number one, that community safety is paramount here, and it is not where we've found ourselves. It has been from rushed legislation. In an ideal world, the UK government would have got in touch with the Scottish government and said, look, these are our proposals, let's work together, and that's the way it would have been done with Wales and Northern Ireland as well, but that's not the way that it happened.
Sure, but it was in the public domain in mid-September. You could have acted quicker if you'd chosen to instead.
We had no detail in mid-September. Well, even the UK government didn't have the detail in mid-September.
You know, your officials have got connections, working connections with officials in the UK level. You know, it just sounds like excuses.
I'm sorry, it's not an excuse.
Thank you.
Fulton McGregor and then Pauline McNeill.
Thanks, Convener. I don't think that it's fair to split the argument between people who... you know, are doing this because it's for public safety, and the other people who have maybe got concerns about the legislation, like myself, is saying that they therefore, or implying that they therefore don't have concerns about public safety. The point that I made at the very beginning was that the animal organisations, the experts, are saying that this will not, that they don't believe that this will make matters more safer. So I just wanted to come on the back of Russell Findlay's last line of question there to say I think that we should unite in saying that everybody around this table and everybody involved in this debate has got public safety at the heart. Disagree on, you know, the legislation, but nobody on either side should take a moral high ground. The question that I've got is quite a brief one. We're obviously in a general election year, Minister. The Labour Party may form the next government. We don't know. Given the concerns about this legislation from stakeholders, and it's probably going to run into more difficulties as it goes along, if a new government in the UK are to remove this legislation, where do we stand? I guess what I really want to know is there a possibility that we could be left with this BIP legislation when the rest of the UK isn't at any point in the future? I know it's a very hypothetical, theoretical question with a lot of moving parts, but it did dawn on me during the discussion to ask that, because I think that would be a really ironic situation if we end up with the legislation here and it's removed elsewhere.
Yes, and I think it is very hypothetical, but it is worth consideration moving forward when we do have a general election. I don't know, Jim, if you wanted to maybe give the background about the court case and...
Absolutely. We are aware that the policy that was introduced by UK government was actually subject to legal challenge. There was a campaign group called Don't Ban Me, License Me, that had pressed for a rethink. And I think the latest position, when I last spoke to DEFRA officials last Friday, is that they expect the campaign group that and had been considered by the courts, but the policy was it was not going to go through a judicial review process, but the campaign group are going to appeal that decision that's been made by the courts. I suppose it's difficult to work out, looking at this, I suppose, through a political lens, where future policy might be made in relation to dog control or dangerous dogs. I think one thing's been clear, though, in terms of the official level, the opportunity to have that discussion on a four nations basis. So the weekly engagement with the UK government DEFRA policy team, just to stress that it's not just between UK government and Scottish government, there is representatives from the Welsh Assembly government and there's representatives from Northern Ireland who engage on a weekly basis. So I think that there's opportunities to perhaps look at a more holistic approach, maybe on a four nations basis when we think about policy development. But I can't control the politics of what might play out in the weeks and months ahead.
And final question, Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much. Interestingly, the 1991 Dangerous Dogs Act is cited as an example in public law as poorly drafted, rushed legislation. I remember that from studying at Strathclyde, so... I think that's why, and I do agree with Fulton McGregor, what we're all concerned about is public safety, so we need to get it right this time. I didn't think you answered Katie Clark's question, which was really, if there was a legal challenge, I mean, this is where we're coming from, as to whether this is an XL bully dog or not. Could a lawyer run circles around the notion that the definition is in guidance and not in the law? And bear in mind, I've just seen the SSI. It's very sparse. We haven't seen the primary legislation. So this is... Can the court rely on the website where the guidance is held as a solid foundation for defending or defining what an XL bully dog is?
I will give to Jim, because Jim will deal with the lawyers and put the SSI in place.
Yeah, I think we can only look at, and it is a, again, it's, I'm trying to compare, well, what's actually happened in England and Wales as a consequence of their policy, especially around concerns around the confirmation standard. The case that was brought forward by the campaign group, you know, did not legally test the policy, because the courts determined that there would be no application for, or the application for judicial review had been refused. So the campaign group have now obviously pressed for an appeal to be made against that decision. I don't know what will play out legally around the concerns that were raised by the campaign group, but the confirmation standard that we have is obviously the same as that was developed by the DEFRA-led expert group.
Position. I mean, well, would you not expect to see a definition if it's so important to decide which dogs are covered and which are not in the SSI or referred to in the SSI?
I just think that we'd run the risk if we had a different type of confirmation standard that will create confusion, and potentially if there was a significant move away from what's actually contained within the UK government standard, I think that will potentially cause confusion. We have heard from organisations like Bedley Gardens, who had suggested that in other jurisdictions in Europe, the definition is different. So you get into the measurements of the dogs. So I just think we need to try and ensure that there is a consistency of approach when it comes to the confirmation standard across the UK.
That I fully understand. Makes complete sense. But England could be in the same position then, which is that in arguing over what the definition is, if the guidance is not seen as legal, because it's just guidance,
surely that can be challenged. But it has been challenged, but the legal challenge was unsuccessful up to this point.
Okay. There's a lot we're not going to be able to cover. I mean, there's a lot of... for example... some who are concerned about legislation talk about the 72% of fatal attacks that take place in the home, concerns about what this will mean for those who've got dogs in terms of their requirement to exercise and so on. Right, okay. I suppose there's been no discussion so far about, and I have a very little knowledge only for what I've been gathering since this became an issue, of what an XL bulldog is. Any discussions about why people are breeding dogs like this? I mean, is there any discussion about that then? Do you then have to maybe tackle the breeders? Because these dog owners, I can understand their concerns now to some extent where, you know, I think you said earlier, Jim, where there's been no evidence of history. Might not even be an XL bully dog, might be borderline, but a large dog who's not aggressive. But is maybe tackling the breeders, is that been part of the discussion?
It has been part of the discussion. I think, as we know, and I think we have to just also reiterate just again that there are lots of XL bully owners that are responsible. There's like very few that are not responsible. But the issue of breeding has come up in my conversations with stakeholders and animal welfare as well. Under my remit, specifically dangerous dogs, and this is where I'm keen to work with Jim Fairley under animal welfare moving forward, because it has been very topical in the last couple of months and it's something that I think we need to look at.
Just finally, if it's reported by, say, someone's neighbour that person... My next door neighbour has an XL bully dog that is not complying with the regulations now, and that's reported to the police. So does that mean that the police will have powers then to come and examine the dog? Is that the process? And then I just wanted to understand what happens.
Yes, there. So I had discussions yesterday with Police Scotland regarding this specific issue with Jim as well, and I'll bring him in a minute. We are moving forward. We've set up the implementation group that I think met for the first time yesterday. We have Police Scotland, local authorities and COSLAW on board to see how we can implement it, because I do understand that there are some concerns about police capacity going out to see every single dog, so we're going to see how we can work with the local authorities as well.
Yep, just to I'll try and be brief. There is what's called the joint protocol between Police Scotland and local authorities that has existed for a number of years, and that is a document that's produced in a fairly high-level way. It's non-statutory status. But it does actually set out who does what when it comes to investigating incidents where a dog is either out of control or dangerously out of control. But at the first meeting of the implementation forum yesterday, we did strike agreement that it would seem like a very good opportunity to actually revisit the joint protocol to set out the operational responses to what happens when a member of the public phones up if they have concerns about a suspected ex-elderly dog, if I can use that as an example. Where do they turn? So we recognise that, you know, there has been quite significant interest from members of the public already that are either, you know, writing into the Scottish Government or will be seeking at least a route to take if they have public safety concerns around a particular dog. I think the one challenge that we have is trying to determine what that demand might be on police and on local authorities if there are dogs that might become ditched, abandoned, and again, it's against the backdrop of a large degree of uncertainty around the actual population of ex-elderly dogs at the moment. So the Implementation Forum is a good place in terms of trying to tackle issues, whether that's around kennelling capacity, whether that's around any operational challenge that could be faced because of soaring demand in terms of numbers of calls from the public, for example. So, yeah, I think, you know, we do have the right individuals on that forum, but take on board the points that have been raised earlier around the need to actually ensure that there is wider engagement, because it's a very complex policy area. It's generated a lot of kind of passionate viewpoints from various stakeholders that we continue to engage with, from members of the public. But we're trying to make the information easily accessible for people.
Question of... So given the discussion we've had about the definition, someone reports a cry, this could be an ex-elderly dog. The police have the powers to go and presumably examine the dog, but they'll have to examine the dog. The purposes of this SSI is against the definition held in the guidance, given the measurements that the Minister talked about, and make a determination then as to whether they think it is a bully dog or not.
Yep.
And then if they think it is, then they then have to take the steps because the owner has not complied. Yeah. Would that sound right?
Yeah, and just very, very briefly, I know that dog legislation officers in England and Wales did actually have to do some upskilling training to give them the tools and the confidence to actually undertake the assessment of ex-elderly dogs. This is an issue that we've discussed yesterday with Police Scotland, and just to stress, the Minister will be having further engagements with Police Scotland going forward. So it won't just be at official level through that implementation forum. There will be opportunities for the Minister to engage with COSLAW through Councillor Chalmers and also Police Scotland officials and senior officials going forward.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. So that completes our evidence taking on the SSI. So our next item of business is to consider a motion to annul the Dangerous Dogs Designated Types Scotland Order of 2024. So a motion to annul has been lodged in the name of Christine Graham. So having had the opportunity now to question the Minister on the SSI, I'm now going to invite the committee to dispose of the motion to annul. So I invite Christine Graham to move motion 12106 in her name, and make any brief additional comments that she wishes to make.
Thank you very much, Convener. I should declare interest as the author of the Control of Dogs Scotland Act 2010, which was about public protection and intervening early. I move my motion to annul But before I give my reasoning, let me emphasise that, like everyone round this table, I'm horrified by dog attacks on people or on other animals. So that's not in question. However, the proposed regulation is not the answer. And the line of questioning I've heard around this table demonstrates that this is bad law. And I say it kindly, I hope, to Sharon Dowie, it's bad law in England and Wales. I'm not getting into constitutional debates. I'm interested in law. And if I get passionate about this, it's not passion without purpose. It's passion about this Parliament delivering good legislation. And what I've heard round this table from many, maybe not all, but from many, is this is not good legislation. Because at the very centre of this is a definition that nobody can give. A bully, XL bully type dog, defined in paragraphs. Whether it's guidance or not, we don't know. And it's so complicated that you can't amend it. Because one thing I've learned about bad law is you can't amend it. I take you back to the offensive behaviour of a football match. Unfortunately, I've been here so long, I remember all these things. It was bad law from start to finish. And it started out in exactly the same trajectory as this. Sensationalism, hasty, brought forward. At least evidence was challenged on it by the committee. I chaired that committee. But at the end of the day, it was repealed. Now, I'm looking at all the things here that are wrong. But the big thing, of course, is definition. And Katie Clark's quite right. Law must be clear. Must be clear for individuals, for the courts, for everybody. This is a burgh. There's nothing clear about this at all. And what's bothering me is we'll almost have public policing. I listened carefully to you about how many have come up here. Nobody knows. You're looking on social media and the newspapers. The day I take evidence for legislation based on social media and newspaper headlines is the day I pack in caring. What we've got to look at here is, was there a better way to do this? Yes, there was. The Control of Dogs Scotland Act should have been tightened up ages ago. There may have been other ways to deal with any dogs being brought up. I don't know. Minister hasn't said, perhaps she might have looked for licensing. We don't have a national microchipping database. I've gone on about this for ages. If we had that national microchipping database, you could identify dogs that were not indigenous to Scotland. But the problem too, apart from all that, is that not bad enough, is the unintended consequences. Now, Fulton McGregor, I know you're very unhappy about this. Fulton McGregor's pinning his hopes, the fact that perhaps Labour gets in, they're pinning their hopes, Labour to get in at Westminster, they might repeal it. But in the meantime, what will have happened? Dogs will have been put down, others will have been neutered, people will have been persecuted. Because that social media, which is providing this very flimsy evidence of the number of dogs coming up, will be a hot spot for people reporting people. I've seen my neighbour or such and such. They've got an XL bully dog, because they don't talk about type. People talk about XL bully dogs. If it's set in stone, they'll be reporting neighbours. And what will happen? The police, who, heaven's sake, have got enough on their plate, will be sent out to measure a dog with a tape measure to see if it complies to the conformation that's been invented by DEFRA. And then if they say, well, we think it's an XL bully, but of course it's got that conformation, the person says, oh, but no, I know my dog's history. It's actually a cross between a boxer and a staffy. I know, because I knew the mother and father and the parents of the dog. There we go. We go to court. There will be court cases. And I know what the court will say about this legislation and about this Parliament and about this committee, by the way. Now, I accept you've been pushed into a corner. But when you're pushed into a corner sometimes, Minister, the thing to do is not just throw your hands in the air. And I know what the position is, but to do something different. And for me, to annul this sends a message to good people south of the border who know it's rubbish and you know it's going to be very, very painful. And you can, and even at the end of the day, if you're an unscrupulous breeder and an unscrupulous owner, and there are a few, most people are not, but a few, you'll just say, OK, I'll breed a dog that can be a fighting status symbol that isn't 20 inches or 19 inches, whatever. I'll make it 18 inches. Doesn't comply. That's what's so stupid about this legislation. So I have to say, I've been a quarter of a century in this Parliament. People might say it's a quarter of a century too long. I've endured so much poor legislation from the offensive behaviour at a football match, which had that hasty start to the ignominious finish, and I'm watching this other one. That's why I'm so angry about it. Because you know, sitting around this table, this isn't good. This isn't good legislation. So I'm saying to the committee, my goodness, this is radical stuff. I'm saying, I hope you came in here with your mind made up to rubber stamp this. Well, all the concerns you've mentioned, all the difficulties, but we'll still rubber stamp it in the hope that something can be done later. You don't do that. You annul it. And you look a different way to deal with the number of dogs, which we don't know what they are, that are coming up from England. You stop dogs being dumped. You stop dogs being put down. You stop good people who have got dogs, lived happily with their neighbours for years, and their neighbours saying, hey, you've got an XL bully hen. I'm not living next door to you anymore. I mean, this is the kind of thing that happens when you do stupid things with legislation. So I'm asking you to annul this. I'm asking the committee to come back and consider a better way forward in the interest, Russell, in the interest of public safety, which is paramount, but just legislation that doesn't demonise a breed, which we don't know what it is, and doesn't demonise owners who are good people. That's my position. I move the motion.
Thank you very much. Okay, I'm now going to invite other members if they would like to come back in and make any further remarks. I would at this point just highlight that, given that we're potentially moving into a debate, I just have to remind Mr. Wilson that he won't be able to come in. So can I ask any other members if they'd like to come in? Russell Finlay.
Just very, very quickly, I was addressed by Christine directly, so I felt it would be rude not to. I believe this legislation is needed and urgently, because it needs to address the risk of public safety, which we all agree on. Where we disagree is how we do that. But I think if you look at it, Police Scotland in the past 4 weeks have had to shoot dead two dogs in the street, both of which may or may not be XL bullies. And I know there's an issue about definition, but if you look at the Bully Watch UK material that's widely available, a lot of that does go some way to explaining that. I find it disappointing that the Scottish Government didn't act quicker. And I know there's a lot of to and fro about that today, and I won't reheat that. And all said, you know, having heard everything, I think it's important that we do support this measure. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Dr.
McGregor.
Yeah, just to say about, I really appreciate Christine Graham's input there. I felt it was very, very powerful, and you can see that just the amount of work that she's done in this whole area. Also, she made a comment about herself. I just wanted to clarify, I'm not pinning my hopes on a Labour backtrack on this. It was a hypothetical question. I've got every feeling that a new government might not be top of the priority list if and when that government changes. I'm sure, disappointingly for Christine Graham, I will be not voting for the annulment today. And that is because I agree almost entirely with what she said. But the one bit where I disagree is that I think that the government have been backed into a corner on this. And really, at this point in time, this is a prudent move to make just now. However, I've also heard the Minister's commitment, both at meetings with myself and today in the committee, that she wants to work through some of the issues that have come up to get to a better place further down the line. But with the UK government passing this legislation at such pace, I think that and the fact that whether they were recorded or not, or they've came from social media, XL bullies have come up and brought up. People have tried to evade the law in England by bringing them up to Scotland. And I think it puts us in a very, very difficult position for that. So on the basis of playing it really safe and nothing more, I will be not voting for the annulment, but supporting the government, SSI.
Okay. Thank you. John Swinney.
Thank you, Convener. Christine Graham has, as ever, made a formidably strong contribution to the debate today, and I share her aspirations and anxiety to be assured about public safety, and associate myself entirely with the concerns that she's expressed about the impact on individuals as a consequence of attacks where these take place. So I am at one with Christine Graham, and I think actually with all members of the committee, about the concerns about public safety and the importance of acting in this respect. I think the Minister and Mr Wilson have demonstrated entirely clearly and convincingly to the committee that the Scottish Government is undertaking regular and assiduous work on dog control to ensure that we have in place in Scotland the appropriate measures through the dog control notice regime, indeed from the legislation that Christine Graham herself pioneered through this Parliament. So I think the public in Scotland should take from this evidence session a great deal of clarity and assurance about the attention to detail that the government is placing and its ministers and officials on the way in which dog control issues have to be managed. But unfortunately, the Scottish Government has been put in an entirely impossible situation by the actions of the United Kingdom Government, who have, with absolutely no consultation, embarked on this approach, which has directly created a loophole which has implications for public safety in Scotland. That is the source of the loophole and the problem and the threat to public safety. So if that issue is not addressed by this committee today, and this is where I unfortunately part company with my dear friend and colleague Christine Graham, we are in danger of increasing the risk to public safety. So I think the government's case has been made convincingly in that respect, because without closing this loophole that's been created by the actions of the United Kingdom government, there is the risk of dogs being transferred to Scotland without proper support, without proper training, without proper assistance, without proper engagement with their owners in an abrupt and distressing fashion. And I can only imagine that that runs the risk of increasing the risks to public safety. Now, if the United Kingdom government had thought more carefully about this legislation, and instead of sending letters to Scottish ministers providing a lack of clarity, and indeed from some news reports that I now read, essentially highlighting the loophole that they themselves have proudly created, if instead of writing these absurd and provocative letters, United Kingdom government ministers had actually thought about making sure the loophole wasn't created in the first place in the English legislation, then this committee would not be considering this issue today, because the arguments that Christine Graham put forward would have had more strength around about them, although they were very strong arguments. But the source of the loophole is the cavalier behaviour of the United Kingdom government. So some people might think that this is about constitutional questions, but for me this gets to the nub of the reckless behaviour that this Parliament is now on the receiving end of from the United Kingdom government. This is an example of shocking disrespect for the powers of this Parliament, a shocking disregard for intergovernmental working. When I get a lecture in this Parliament from one of my opponents again about the fact that there's something wrong with the engagement of the Scottish Government with the UK Government, I'm going to cite this, because this is an example of shocking disrespect for the process of decision-making within the United Kingdom. Shocking disregard for the intergovernmental frameworks that are supposed to be our protection. So to anybody looking at this and thinking that all is well in the way in which this Parliament relates to the other parliaments and governments of the United Kingdom, this is a wake-up call, because this is an example of a UK government that creates mayhem by its actions and doesn't care about the consequences for the devolved settlement. So I'm afraid, reluctantly, I won't be in a position to support Christine Graham in her motion today, but I think the government has been put in an entirely impossible position, and the order in front of us today is an inevitable consequence of that. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. First of all, can I thank Christine Graham? Please don't ever stop giving your impassioned speeches about the importance of passing good quality legislation. I really value your contribution. Because you have given me some food for thought, I'll say that. I want to start by saying, I mean, as someone who has proudly supported devolution, the devolution settlement, and I fought for it, I believe in it. I do think there has been long periods of failures on intergovernmental activity, and this one, I am concerned that the Scottish Government were not formally notified. I think that's wrong, and I think it goes against the grain of what I believe in as someone who supports the devolved settlement. So that does give me cause for concern. I've also got concerns, as raised by Katie Clark as well, just about the definition. I do worry that the lack of a definition enshrined in not only in the legislation, but the I suppose the parameters of what's an XL bully dog and it's not, I think we'll have to return to this question. As I said, and openly, you know, I've got limited understanding of the issue only since it did appear in the news that I started to pay attention, try to understand it. But it does seem that there are problems with the breed in general, which is why I asked the question about why we're not talking, you know, at the beginning of the process, the why breeders are breeding such large dogs, which need, you know, probably more exercise than most and need to be under more control than most. And that, as mentioned by others, we've had some horrific examples. And it won't be the only breed where there's been an issue about control and dangers to life. But what concerns me when I look at it all is the fact we do have a loophole. And as the Minister said at the beginning, as I understand it, the framework of the English legislation has banned taking dogs out of England and Wales. It is an offence to bring a dog to Scotland. But the only way in which it can be enforced is if there is parallel legislation. It was my understanding from the beginning, which is why I did comment on it. I would hope that although this committee are concerned with the justice issues to make sure that we've made and we just have to make a, you know, we have to make a decision today. We haven't long to think about it. And that's the thing about SSIs generally, even when they're controversial, you do get limited time to deal with it. But there are animal welfare issues. There are issues raised by Elizabeth impact on vets. Not for this committee, but as an animal lover myself, as a large dog, as the German Shepherd, I am interested and concerned about these issues, and I hope that ministers continue to have the relevant conversations with the relevant committee around animal welfare issues. For those reasons, having to make a decision, I don't want to abstain on something like this. I will be voting against the annulment, but those are my reasons set out.
Thank you very much indeed. Katie Clark, do you want to come in?
Yes, thank you. I think the debate today has highlighted again the need for dangerous dogs legislation to be updated urgently. I know the Scottish Government has done work on that, and I hope that we do see a bill sooner rather than later, because dog attacks in Scotland have risen by 80% in the last decade, even in the last year, and dog attacks in postal workers have increased by 15%. And it's the attacks that have taken place recently, some of the horrific attacks, that will determine how I will vote today. Not because I think this particular statutory instrument is well drafted or the solution, but I think it will address some of the problem, and therefore I would feel that I would have no choice but to support it today for community safety reasons. But I would hope that the points that Christine Graham has so powerfully made in terms of the quality of the legislation that we pass are taken on board by the Scottish Parliament, because it's a point that is repeatedly made in terms of the quality of the legislation. From what I can understand from what the Minister's saying, the reason it's being defined in this way is simply to mirror the approach being taken down south. I would question whether that is the right approach. However, this is the statutory instrument we have in front of us today. We cannot amend it. If we reject it, it will be some time before more proposals come back. And on that basis, I would feel that I would have to support the Scottish Government position today.
OK, thank you very much indeed. I wonder if I could just come in at this point and probably just reflect some or many of the comments that have been made by members. I think we would rather not be here in this committee room having to go through this process today. And like other members, I commend Christine Graham for her tenacity, for her absolute commitment to animal welfare. And I think the very articulate way and detailed way in which she has set out her position. I do think, like other members, the Scottish Government has been put in an extremely difficult situation. And I think given the level of engagement that we know the Scottish Government has undertaken, I do think that what we are dealing with today, if there had been a different option, then we would have probably been dealing with that. I'd like to thank certainly Mr. Wilson. I think both Mr. Wilson and the Minister have set out in some detail what the issues that that we are all facing and grappling with. But I think importantly going forward in and around some of the monitoring and continued engagement, which is vitally important in this particular issue. So, like other members, reluctantly, I'll not be able to support the motion to annul this morning. Bob Doris, I don't know if you want to come in at all, or you're happy, content
so
to...
I was keeping my head down, Cunha. I wasn't sure if I was permitted to come in at this stage, because I'm not a member of the committee. I think it would just be to reiterate some of the views the committee members have done. First of all, I commend the committee members on their interrogation of this statutory instrument. It's been really worthwhile exercising how scrutiny should take place. And Christine Graham won't thank me for what she'll think is patronising, and it's not patronising. I commend you in your endeavours, very forensic endeavours in relation to this. And if I was you, I wouldn't be happy at the outcome of what's likely to be the vote here this morning. But I said during my contribution, and however we frame it, this may make our communities a wee bit safer by passing this statutory instrument. It's not where I want to be. It's not where the committee wants to be. It's not where Parliament wants to be. But not to act, I think, would be wrong. And I think I said during my contribution that passing this legislation is better than not passing any legislation. But the real task, actually, are the next statutory instrument, but I may not be so kind to my own government and the details in relation to that, but also in relation to future work, where I think we have to see early sight of the government's thoughts in relation to future work and reform in this area. And I thank you, Cunha, for allowing me to come in and make those points.
OK, thank you very much. Can I invite the Minister just to respond to any of the points that have been made?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Yeah, just to reiterate, it's not an ideal situation for us to be in, and this decision has not come lightly. Moving forward, I hope we're never in this position again, and I think for that to happen, there has to be reform in legislation, and I'm willing to work under my remit with Dangerous Dogs and hopefully with Mr. Fairley, the new Minister, under animal welfare together and how we can make this necessary reform.
Thank you, Minister. Can I now invite Christine Graham to make any further brief final remarks and indicate whether you intend pressing or withdrawing your motion?
Well, I'm not surprised that it's not being annulled. I think it has been... I know there's unhappiness around this table. I think there's a breathing space before the next natural instrument, which is the big bad one, comes along, maybe to put something else in its place. I lay that only... I know you've been under pressure with the threat of dogs being brought up, but there may be a pause where we can look at not proceeding to the second part. I just lay that down without notice. I thank members for their contributions. As I say, my passion is about legislation. Can I help it? You can't take the lawyer out of me. And Katie Clark's in the same boat as Polly McNeill. You can't help yourself. And I appreciate where the committee is. But I think what's been put on the record today is extremely important. And I hope that we can come back to the next statutory instrument, maybe being able to do something else. That's all I'll say. Thank you very much for your tolerance. And I like being patronised.
Can I just ask if you're
pressing? I'm pressing it. Of course I'm pressing
you're pressing
it.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Okay, so the question is that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the motion to annul the Dangerous Dogs Designated Type Scotland Order of 2024 be agreed. So are we agreed?
No.
Okay. We are not agreed, so we'll go to a vote. So if I can ask for those in favour of annulling, raise your hands. Thank you. Against annulling, raise your hands. And there'll be no, any abstentions? Just checking. No abstentions. Thank you. Okay. So thank you. So there are no votes in favour of annulling. There are 8 votes against annulling. There are no abstentions, and therefore the motion is not agreed. Okay. Okay. So thank you very much indeed, everyone. We'll just have a short suspension just to allow our witnesses to leave. Thank you. Okay, thank you, members. Our next item of business is consideration of a legislative consent memorandum for the Investigatory Powers Amendment Bill, UK Parliament legislation. And I refer members to paper 2. So can I invite any views or comments from members, including on whether the committee wishes to recommend to the Parliament that consent be given to the relevant provisions in the bill. Anyone got any particular comments to make? Russell Finlay.
A very quick observation. I'm by no means an expert on what the entirety of this is proposing, but I do suggest that we support it. There's one element that did catch my eye, which is the creation of a new subsection which requires the Investigatory Powers Commissioner to notify those who have been subject of inappropriate surveillance or such like by the authorities. And I think that's pertinent given recent cases involving a case which I can't go into detail about, in which journalists were subject and journalists' alleged or suspected sources were subject to inappropriate techniques by Police Scotland, which relating to a serious crime. So if this measure helps to tighten it up and put an onus on informing those who have been subject to wrongful methods such as these, then that can be only a good thing. So, thank
okay,
you.
Okay, thank you. That's a helpful point. Any other points that members would like to make? Okay, can I just confirm in that case that members are content to recommend to the Parliament that consent be given to the relevant provisions in the bill? Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. So that concludes the public part of today's meeting, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.